Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Meadowview United Methodist Church, 768 Summit Road, Eden, North Carolina. Happy Valentine's Day. Tuesday's almost here, and we'll talk about love a little bit today in a little different way. We had a wonderful Valentine banquet last night. Food was delicious. Fellowship was great. We just had a wonderful time last night. So glad that we were able to do that, and look forward to many other times when we can get together and celebrate many different causes. For our announcements today, notice who's not here and let them know we missed them. Bingo starts back in April. It's not that far now. Pray for the country of Ukraine. We need bingo prizes for the nursing home. We're collecting food for the food pantry at Spray. We're teaming up with them. February the 22nd is Ash Wednesday, and there's going to be a special service at Spray United Methodist Church. I'm helping with the service. And our church is invited to come and be a part of that service. It's February the 22nd at 7 p.m. I'm sure you've got your calendar events by now, and hopefully it is posted so you'll know what's going on. I feel really good that I have the finished draft of our end of the year report. Diane, thank you so much. When I needed financial information, I could go to your end of the year report for 2022, and I've only had to call you one time this time. So you've done an excellent job, and I appreciate your help, but I'll get that hopefully submitted sometime tonight. It's due by the 15th. I got a memo a couple of nights ago. I had already logged into it and printed off a rough copy, so I always work from a paper copy rather than typing straight into the computer. And the email said there were 36 churches that still had not started their end of the year report. So that's something that has to be in. It has to be in on time. So that's very important. I feel very good to have that almost finished. When I submit it, then it is finished. Do we have other announcements this morning? Do we have any birthdays? Anniversaries? Okay. Let us stand as we're able. You should have a sheet there at your seat. Love Lifted Me. It's an old song. It's in our red hymn book. But I made copies for everybody. And again, Love Lifted Me.
Thank you.
called to worship. I will praise you, O Lord, with all of my heart.
We will praise you for your love and faithfulness.
For you have exalted above all things your name and your words.
Bless the name of the blessed Lord. The glory of the Lord is great.
You may be seated. If you'll turn in your hymn book again to page 170. Oh, how I love Jesus. 170. Other blessings. I was blessed this week. Duke Energy, after 7 weeks, finally came to this little cabin. Some of you went many years ago fishing over and went with Fish and Wildlife Club. A pine tree had knocked the meter off of my little cabin. It's made out of a horse table. Very primitive one room. But anyway, they finally came, and after my electrician had done his magic and finally got the electricity hooked up to the cabin. So now I can go in and clean up and look at all the damage a couple of squirrels or chipmunks that got into the cabin did this last year. So I'm very thankful for that. Other blessings. God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Amen. Our responsive reading is found on page 807. It's Psalm 89, 807. It continues on the next page. Please join with me. I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations.
Your steadfast love is as forever. Your faithfulness is firm as the heavens.
You have said, I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn to David, my servant.
I will establish your descendants forever.
Then you spoke in a vision to your faithful one and said,
I have set a crown upon the one who is mighty. I have exalted your chosen people.
I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him.
So that my hand shall never abide with him.
The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him.
I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him.
My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and in my name shall his horn be exalted.
I will send his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers.
He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation.
And I will make him the firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth.
My steadfast love I will keep for him forever, and my covenant will stand firm for him.
I will establish his line forever, and his throne in his days of heavens.
If his children forsake my law, and do not walk according to my ordinances, then I will punish their transgression with a rod and their iniquity with scourges. I will not violate my covenant or alter the word that went forth from my lips. His line shall endure forever. His throne as long as the sun is before me.
Like the moon, it shall be established forever. It shall stand firm on the skies of your universe.
Today, our schools, Shirley Stevens, Karen Johnson, the country of Ukraine, Peggy Kendrick, Denise Wentz, Lois Kezar, Dwayne Jeffries, Marie Brooks, Barney McBride, Luann Joyce, Kay Price, UNC Rockingham Rehab, Bill Abisky's family, Sherry and Chad, Deborah Feeney, Bill Abisky, Ricky Hall, Cindy Bowling, Joe Bowling, Betty Booth, Caitlin and Cameron, Jackie Carter, Maya Gardner, Mildred Leek, Rodney Chapman and family, Linda Shropshire, like Gordon, Kathy Sawyers, Sylvia Bryant, Woody, Paul Jeffries, and the Willis Overby family. Willis Overby was one of the leaders in Snow Hill United Methodist Church, where I was first an associate pastor many years ago. He was also the assistant superintendent of schools and just involved in everything there. But he was such a wonderful help to me getting started in the ministry as a laity. And when he passed away, I want to remember his family as well. I knew you wouldn't know who he was if I didn't share just a little bit with you. Do we have updates or others that we need to aim? Yes.
Yeah, Sylvia, you can remove her name. Sylvia Bryant, okay. She's doing a whole lot better.
Thank you. Others? Let us pause for our meditation and our prayers. Teaching us how to love, even though our love is nothing compared to yours. Lord, be with all those that are sick, those that are recuperating at home, those that are in hospitals and hospice, just wherever they might be. Be not only with the patient, but all that is helping with their care and their recovery. Lord, be with those that are grieving. It's a long process, and we need your peace and comfort as we move forward. Lord, individuals and families have all kinds of concerns, things that we're worried about, paying the house payment or the mortgage, the rent, being able to buy food and put gas in the car, being able to just do the best we can just to maintain our existence. Help us to solve the various problems that people are concerned about, and help us to be able to move forward and remember to turn to you for help. Lord, be with this church. Help us as we serve you within our congregation, with in the community, and reaching out into the world. Help us to do your will. Be with the United Methodist Church as it struggles with division. Many churches leaving the United Methodist conferences. Lord, be with our country. Protect us from enemies. Help us to be able to think clearly and make wise decisions. Help our economy to improve. Be with our first responders, our police officers, our firemen, our EMCs. Just protect them as they try to do their job. Lord, you're an awesome God. We thank you for your holy word. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who came and gave us an example and gave us words to consider and think about and treasure. We thank you for his death and resurrection, that by believing in him we will have eternal life. It's a promise, and you are true to your word. Lead and guide us, Father, for we ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Judy, if you'll come up and we'll have our collection. I think you can do both sides. Let us stand for the doxology, please.
Praise God.
Thank you for these gifts. We ask your blessings upon them. Help us to reach out within the church and outside of the church to serve you with these. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming up. For our special music today, I'm going to play a song that's done by Greater Vision. Just ask.
Alone in the darkness, you're wondering.
are so fortunate above so many people out in the world today, knowing that Jesus is with us. No matter what our situation is, He's going to help us. We're not by ourselves, like so many people have no one to rely upon. We can always rely upon God.
Amen.
Amen. Our scripture today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 15. I'm reading a little longer than sometimes. I'm reading from verses 11 through 32 to the end of the chapter. I'm reading from the King James Version. Again, Luke 15, beginning with verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country. And there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a great famine in the land and began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. And no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's house have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am not worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am not worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring hither the fatted calf and kill it and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked, what did these things mean? And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry, and would not go in. Therefore came the father out and entreated him. And he answered and said to his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment, and yet thou never gavest me a kid, that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto his son, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meant that we should make merry and be glad. For this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
My Valentine sermon, if you want to call it that, is a little different than you might would expect today, but that's okay. My sermon is entitled, Love Always Wins, Sometimes. It sometimes seems that we spend the first 10 or 12 years of our life learning great rules, and then spend the remainder of our years discovering exceptions to those rules. There's a story about this in the Bible. Everyone knows that love always wins. Yet, like it or not, most of us, as time goes by, witness instances when love doesn't win. Or if love wins, the victory comes so late that it hardly matters. That's hard to accept. Having been nurtured in the faith that love always comes out on top, we try to ignore those times when it seems to work otherwise. But when we insist that love invariably wins, experience answers only sometimes. One day, Jesus overheard some religious leaders criticizing him for associating with questionables in society. He answered by telling them three stories. The last of the three is often said to be the most beautiful short story ever written. A certain man, Jesus said, like our scripture says today, had two sons. On the surface, they were very different. The older son worked hard on the family farm. The younger son was restless. The family lifestyle bored him, while the glamour of the distant city fascinated and enticed him. One day, the younger son asked his father if he could make an early claim on his inheritance. "Let me have my share now," he said, "so that I can go and test my wings and do my thing." The father, a generous man, perhaps overly generous, agreed, and before long the boy was headed off to the big city that he had dreamed about for so long. Soon he was living in the fast lane. With his rather substantial inheritance, he found friends very quickly, as you can imagine. And they helped him find ways to spend his money. Before he knew it, almost overnight, it seemed his money was gone. And not surprisingly, his new friends were gone too. Now he was forced to scrape and struggle for a living. He was driven at last to feed pigs, the ugliest of jobs for a first century Jew. Jews weren't supposed to have anything to do with swine, pork. As he fed the pigs, he envied them, for their diet was better than his own. And then he came to his senses. "I'm going home," he said. "My father's servants live better than I do." So home he went, weary, threadbare, sick of body, sick of life, sick of himself. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him. And that phrase all by itself lets us know how loving a man his father was. We can only conclude that the father had been waiting for this boy almost from the day that he had left. So it was that he saw him while he was still a great way off. And believe me, that distant look is a measure of love. Struggling and stumbling, the boy came. He had probably been gone no more than a year, but it was as if he had been gone 20 years. "Father," he wept, "I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." The father interrupted the confession with his own song of love and joy. "Get the best robe for the boy," he told his servant. "Get a ring for his finger and shoes for his feet. Kill our best calf and set up for a party. The boy I lost has returned. We are going to celebrate." It was a marvelous scene. The celebration of victory of love. But it isn't the end of the story. I wish it were the end of the story. As the party gained momentum, the older son came in from the fields. When he heard what was happening, he was bitterly angry. "You never had a party for me," he said to his father. "I've worked hard all of these years, and you never did anything nice like this for me." And again, the father responded in love. He tried to explain to his older son not only why he felt such joy in the younger son's return, but also his depth of love for him, the older son. But we never know whether the older son responded to his father's love or not, because the story ends there, leaving the outcome uncertain. We don't know if love won. We hope so. Our sentimental longing for a happy ending causes us to assume that surely love must have won. But neither Jesus nor the gospel tells us. When we read this story or our preacher teach it, what we usually concentrate on the boy that left home. That's natural, because his story is by far the most exciting. It's a sort of story that quickly gains our interest. Occasionally, someone pays attention to the story of the older brother, as I will do in a little bit. But there's another way to approach this story, and that's from the point of view of the father. We don't know his name. Of course, Jesus almost never gives us the names of the characters that he has in his parables. Perhaps because names would distract his listeners from applying the parables to themselves. But for purposes of ease and storytelling, I'm going to call the father Zechariah. He was a loving father, even to the point of indulgence. The kind of father whom neighbors would say, he gives those kids too much for their own good. In this, he was, of course, like God, who has been so expressively generous in his endowments to our human race. So it was with this man. It probably wasn't the wise thing to do. The boy must have been terribly spoiled even to suggest such a thing as getting his inheritance. And the father only encouraged the boy's self-centeredness by giving in to his way. I have a feeling the father often erred on the side of kindness. Someone might say, if you're going to err, isn't that the way to go? After all, you can't love too much, can you? That's probably what the father said too, provided he considered the matter at all. It's quite possible he didn't even think about it. That he was just doing what came naturally to him. I can imagine the conversations that took place in the nearby town where the family was well known. Word got out that the father had given the younger son his inheritance. One townsman stopped another. Did you hear what old Zach did? He's given the young boy his share of the family estate. The kid doesn't know his head from a bunch of grapes. And now he's got all that money. Mark you, it will do him no good. A week or two went by. Some of the townspeople were talking again. Hear the latest about Zechariah and his boys? The young boy just left home. I'm not surprised, the neighbor said. Not surprised at all. I knew he'd do something like that the moment I heard about that fool thing that Zach did with the inheritance. No, sir, it doesn't surprise me at all. I think I told you that it would happen, didn't I? Do you remember me telling you that? A month went by. I was in the city last week, a man reported. You can't guess what I saw. Old Zach's boy. I want to tell you, he was living it up. He had a blonde on one arm and a brunette on the other. Both good lookers, too. I don't know much about clothes, but I'm tell you, he didn't buy his clothes at a discount store. You know what they say? His neighbor answered, "A fool and his money are soon departed." Zach should have known better than to give that boy that money. Zach's a good fellow. He's as nice a fellow as you'd ever hope to meet. But he's just too kind. Especially where his boys are concerned. 6 months went by. "Do you suppose Zach knows what's happened to his boy?" a man asked. "What do you mean?" "I mean the trouble he's gotten into. The fool kid's apparently spent all of his money, every thin mite of it. And to make it worse, the bottom's fallen out of the business in the city. Real estate's at a standstill. There's hardly a job to be found. A lot of businesses are closing down." "Sure, sure, but what's happened to Zach's boy?" "Well, a fellow saw him the other day, Samuel, I think it was, said he looked like Skid Row revisited. Hardly enough rags to cover his hindquarters." "What was he doing, panhandling?" "Worse, he was feeding pigs. Honest. And to tell you the truth," Sam said, "the boy looked like he envied the pigs their food." The second man shook his head for a moment and then shifted his ever-present straw. "You know, it's hard to understand. Old Zach loved that boy so much. Well, both of them for that matter. And Zach's such a good man, but that fool kid has gone to the devil. And as far as I'm concerned, Zach's done nothing but right by him. It just makes you wonder what good it does to love somebody. It sure doesn't seem possible. I just wonder." And then one morning there was a different kind of conversation. "Hear the good news about Zach and his younger boy?" "Man, everybody's heard. Why, you could hear the orchestra playing halfway across town last night. I've never known that kind of celebration that old Zach threw for his boy's homecoming. I'm sure glad for Zachariah. The boy's thin as a skeleton. But he looked happy, glad to be home, I guess. It wasn't all good, though," the second man said. "Just as the party was getting strong last night, the older boy came in from the fields. Always been hard feelings between those two boys, you know. They're so different in so many ways. Well, the older boy just couldn't have anything to do with that party. I understood that old Zach stood outside and begged him to come in. They say that he had tears in his eyes. Did the older boy ever go in? I don't rightly know. My friend, the one who told me this part, felt embarrassed to listen any further. He said Zachariah was just a begging his boy, pleading with him to join the celebration. You know, the older one never had been much like his father. You wonder how he could grow up with an old man like his and still be as mean-spirited as he was. Mind you, he's honest and he's hard-working, but nothing like Zach. You just can't help wondering why Zach's boys hadn't turned out better than they have. It sure isn't because they lack love, I can tell you that. That's the question I live with you on the Father's behalf. Why doesn't love always win? A proverb often seen on Sunday school walls says that children become like what they live with. Let them live with anger, and they grow up to be angry people. Let them live with love, and they grow up to be loving people. The odds are definitely with that philosophy. If you're a betting person, you can lay your bet on love producing love and hate producing hate. Judging from what we know and see, however, isn't a sure thing. some people who grow up with love simply become spoiled. And some children whose parents are mean, they seem to grow up demanding and insistent. And if the patience of the parents had taught them that they can always get what they want, it only holds out long enough. So it is with some friendships and marriages. Rather than learning unselfishness from the other, a partner seems to know how to exploit the other person's good nature. People learn, as the saying goes, what buttons to push in order to get their own way. We wonder how the father in Jesus' parable, the man I've called Zechariah, could have two sons, the sort we found in the story. The younger son so selfish in his younger days until his life painfully awakened him and he sought the inheritance early, being indifferent to his father's feelings, and he was so foolish that he wasted it in drunken, lecherous living. Surely he didn't learn that kind of conduct from his dad. And the older brother was so self-centered that he couldn't rejoice in his father's happiness. All he could think about was that he had never had a party to compare with this one. His attitude, his personality was so unlike his father's. Where did the father fail? How is it that his love, which is so apparent, so admirable, didn't win? Well, love is risky. The outcome depends on the response of the other party. Worse yet, love has to work with the most unpredictable of creatures, a human being. With love, you have to depend on the response of the other person, and that's always a gamble. Yet that's the way God is choosing to relate to this world of ours. God is the Father in this parable. How then does God feel when he looks out on his sons and his daughter, out on us? Does God sometimes say, why haven't they responded properly to my love? Apparently so, at least that's the way the prophet Jeremiah said it. So many centuries ago, speaking for God, Jeremiah said these words, what wrong did your fathers find in me, that they went far from me and went after worthlessness and became worthless? That is, why didn't they follow my example? How is it that they could observe my love and grace and then choose a shoddy, self-destructive way? The prophet Hosea described the divine anguishly, but in their diligence and dullness of spirit, they didn't recognize who it was that had healed them in those days, or who was caring for them, or that they were the beneficiaries of love. Likewise, Jesus made the case for tears. Weeping over Jerusalem in the last days of his earthly life, Jesus said, I would have gathered you the way a chicken gathers her little ones under her wings, and you would not. The Bible is not a collection of decrees or a description of the divine attributes, but it's more a story of God, the jilted lover. One would think God would have grown tired of loving our world, or that he would have given up on us. Instead, he keeps on believing in love, and in us, and our potential to respond with love. Love's a risky business, no doubt about it. And in a sense, it's surprising that love ever succeeds, because love depends on such gentle, uncontrolling methods. Love is the method God has chosen to use. If God believes in love so much, it's obviously worth trying. So I suggest some guidelines for love If love doesn't win now, wait. Perhaps it will win down the road for those who, just like the Father in the parable, they go out and see the wanderer still a long way off. If the facts of life seem to prove that, in some cases, love never wins, then keep on loving, no matter what. For this is the way God loves, and it's the way we, therefore, ought to follow. Love doesn't have to win, because love is right. Even when love doesn't win, love is right. And if love never wins in this lifetime, say to yourself that heaven can wait. Faith never said that we must see results while we live. In our own relationship to the Lord God, let us answer His love by loving Him. He is the one who loves all of His sons and daughters, even in their most unlovable times. So let us love Him, this unparalleled lover, in return. Let us love God. Let us pray. Lord, thank You for Your love. Strengthen our own love that we can share it back with You and with others. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our closing hymn today, Jesus Loves Me. Sometimes I think of that as a kid's song. It's a song for all of us. It's found on page 191. Let us stand as we're able. 191. Church signed with that song. So it's a beautiful song. Thank you for being here. Have a wonderful Valentine's Day on Tuesday. Go forth in peace, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.